It is on. Good. So I'm kind of a computer nerd. I've been surrounded by computers my whole life, like most of you, but I've also been engineering them my whole life. And what I really like about computers are the absolutely beautiful algorithms that we've created and the programming languages that we represent those algorithms in. And I've always been fascinated in biology as well, because living organisms are essentially naturally occurring computers. The DNA in the living organisms is the code, and if you change that code, you change the behavior of the organism. And so this combination of computer science and biology is called synthetic biology. And I've been doing this for about 6 years, and I've come to the conclusion that really, eventually, biology will be as easy to program as computers are now. You might use some kind of programming language that you're used to, like Python or Java, if you know these things, and that language will be compiled down into DNA, and you'll stick the DNA inside cells, boot it up, and it will go. And it sounds kind of crazy, and I think that eventually we're going to have to really change our mindset in order to get there, because there are a lot of differences between biology and computers as well, as I'll get to. So today what I'm going to tell you is how we're learning to program biology by actually programming it indirectly. What we're doing is we're programming the biology lab, and that allows us to turn the biology lab into a programmable system that you can use as a tool to find new living cells that do new and useful things. So how easy is it to program a computer anyway? So you might not be computer savvy yourself, and you might think computers are really mysterious, but just remember, everything that your computer does was programmed by somebody. This is my son, Brendan. He's 9. He's not actually playing video games in this picture. He's actually writing his own video game. He learned how to write video games in elementary school. They teach programming in elementary school, which is mind-boggling to me. It's so fantastic. And what that probably means is that programming, even though these kids are smart, programming is about as difficult to do as doing fractions. So if you can do fractions, you can program a computer. Imagine if biology were that easy to program. Imagine if we could be that creative with biology. Why are computers so easy to program? Well, it's because we've figured out where to put these abstraction barriers so that you don't need to think about all the stuff that's happening inside a computer. The thing about humans is that they can really only keep a few ideas in their head at any given time. And if you have to know about everything that's happening inside a computer, from the transistor all the way up to the programming language, you'll just be completely paralyzed and you won't be able to be creative. And so the beauty of computers and computer languages is that you can write a few lines of code. It's almost like poetry, and it will get compiled down into behaviors for those transistors that can implement your code and do what your code says. So I think this idea of abstraction can be applied to biology as well. We just have to figure out where that abstraction barrier is. So we've been hacking biology for a long time. Just as an example, insulin is currently made in a transgenic yeast, where we've taken a gene from humans that codes for insulin, stuck it into the yeast, and we grow the yeast in vats, kind of like if you're making beer, and we skim the insulin off the top, and that's where the world supply of insulin comes from. Making a molecule inside a cell has become pretty standard. Synthetic biology wants to go a little bit further and say, well, what if we could wrap some logic around that? What if we could say, only make that molecule in specific situations? Maybe we could do something like make a gene circuit. You take the gene circuit, you put it into a patient, and the gene circuit recognizes, using some logic, am I in a cancer cell or am I in a normal cell? And in a normal cell, it wouldn't make that molecule. In the cancer cell, it would, and maybe that molecule kills the cell. It could be an incredibly specific cancer therapy. That's the kind of stuff that synthetic biologists like to work on. But I actually think that the computer programming applied to biology could do even more amazing things than that. I think the sky's the limit. If you look at nature and all of the amazing things that it does, we could learn to do that too someday if we could figure out how to program biology. And I want to talk a little bit about what really drives me to want to program biology. It's graphs like this. So there's time on the x-axis and all sorts of sort of alarming things on the y-axis. Carbon dioxide, extinctions per year, the population size, etc. All of these things are indicators of a biosphere that's essentially crashing. And from a computer science point of view, that's alarming because hundreds of millions of years of code is just going poof. It's beautiful code, and it's gone. And more of it is going away every day. What are we going to replace it with? Are we going to wait another 100 million years for more code to evolve? Are we going to breed our way out of this by breeding new crops and things like that that take thousands of years? Or are we going to learn to program like nature does? I think we owe it to nature to figure out how to learn to program biology. So I took these ideas of computer science and hacking genetics and figured I would go into the lab and do some programming. So I took a really simple program. Basically turn on, turn off, turn on, turn off. It's like a while loop. It just goes on and on and on. And I tried to get that to work inside cells. So here's some yeast cells. They're yellow right now, and as I run this, you'll see they turn off the yellow, and then they turn it back on, and they turn it off, and they turn it on. It's got some genes from plants in it. It's got some genes from jellyfish in it. It's a true transgenic program where we learned how to program a little one line of code. It's really cool, and plant geneticists and yeast geneticists think it's great. But computer scientists look at this and say, it's one line of code. How long did that take you? And I say, well, it took us about 3 years to get this to work. Not only that, we had to know everything from the program we wanted to write all the way down to how to wash dishes in the lab, because if we washed them the wrong way, there'd be stuff left on them that would screw up our experiments. I mean, it's literally that complicated of a process. In fact, this is what my lab looked like. Still does, more or less. There's all sorts of things happening in there. It's an incredibly complicated process to engineer biology. You've got test tubes, you've got equipment, you've got lab technicians, you've got to train them, you've got to figure out all this stuff, you've got to keep track of thousands and thousands of samples and the information contained in them. So it's a very complicated process. And as I'm down there pipetting colorless liquids from one tube into the other, I kept thinking to myself, any day now, this is going to feel like programming. It never really felt like programming. In fact, there aren't any computers there, and I spent years not programming at all, which for me actually kind of sucked. So I began to think, well, maybe I'm thinking about this programming biology business the wrong way. So I started looking at the differences between computers and biology, because there obviously are some. So in computers, you get a programming manual. The programming manual tells you everything that's going on inside your computer, from the hard drives to the monitor, to the programming languages, and the meaning of all the statements in your programming language. So you can really use that to write programs, and you know what's going on. In biology, you can look at the DNA for a living organism all you want. You're not going to figure out what it does until you go to the lab and start doing experiments on it. If I change this little bit of DNA, what happens? If I change that bit of DNA, what happens? And in order to do those experiments, you use recipes. Those recipes have been handed down from generation to generation of biologists. This is how you do it. And you learn those recipes in a sort of master-apprentice way. That's nothing like computers, where my kid can learn to program at school. And because there's no computer programming manual, you can't just write code. You can't say, I want to build, you know, therapy X. And then you start coding it up, and you have a debugger and an online simulator, and it just gives you, it allows you to write this code. What you have to do instead is guess at a piece of DNA that you think is going to work, and do some experiments on it. You find out it doesn't work, it almost always doesn't work, and then you tweak it a little bit, and you run it again, you tweak it a little bit, and run it again. So every single thing in our lab that we got to work, and there's only a handful of things, for every one of those, there's thousands of samples of strains of yeast and bacteria in our freezer with DNA in them that essentially does nothing. And that's actually really discouraging if you're a computer programmer and you're used to sort of typing a program, clicking OK, and seeing all these things happen. Here, you make some DNA, and months later, you still don't have anything working. And then one of the biggest differences we saw is that it's hard to use other people's code. So in computers, if you write a program, I can take that program and run it on my own computer, and it'll just work. And I can give it to you, and you can run it on your computer, and it'll work too. That's an amazing thing about computer programs. I took that idea into engineering biology. I thought, well, I read this paper. They said I could do such and such a thing with this gene in yeast, so I should be able to do that in yeast too in my lab. And I would try it and it wouldn't work. And I thought, well, I'm a computer scientist, what do I know? I'll just try it again with another paper and I'll keep going. And it was amazing. I could never get anybody else's results to work, and I almost quit because this seemed just ridiculous. It turned out that it wasn't actually my problem. So when a researcher tells you what they did, often in a biology lab, this is what they give you. They give you their lab notebook. What their lab notebook has in it is a bunch of stuff that they use to remember what they did yesterday so that they could do a similar thing today. But it doesn't contain all sorts of other information. It doesn't contain information that they just take for granted about how they do these processes. It doesn't certainly contain information about things like whether the refrigerator door was open too long and maybe that affected the results of your experiment, or what the humidity in the room was, or what kind of glassware you're using, right? All of these things actually affect the experiments, and if you don't know them, you can't reproduce the experiments. So there was a study done recently by some researchers at Amgen who have very well-equipped labs and they have lots of expertise, where they took 53 seminal results in cancer biology. They took all the information that was published about them and tried to reproduce those results. And out of 53 results, they only got 6 to work. It's just really pathetic. That's millions of dollars of research money that has produced results that nobody else can reproduce. And it makes progress in programming biology and medicine and agriculture and bioremediation and everything else you want to do with biotechnology really slow and prone to error. So what do we do about this? So as I'm sitting in the lab pipetting colorless liquids, I began to realize that what we don't want to do is program the cells directly. I mean, we eventually do, but what we probably have to do is figure out how to program the lab. All these processes that are happening in the lab, there ought to be some programming language that can represent those so that we can do them over and over again and share code and so on. So we started building a programming language. It's a totally new programming language that allows us not to program computers, but to program the biology lab. So in that language, there are, of course, things like DNA and cells that you can refer to syntactically. But there's a whole bunch of other nouns in our language as well, things like bottles and plates and cells and test tubes. These are the things that you actually manipulate in the lab in order to do your biology experiments. And we also added to our language a whole bunch of verbs like cut and heat and cool and stir and measure. These are also the kinds of things that you do in the lab to do your experiments. And when you take all of these notions and put them together in a language, you can represent those recipes in a really formal way and say exactly what you want to have happen with your experiment. So we prototyped this system, and we call it Aquarium. You get to program the lab. We supply you with a whole bunch of recipes that you can string together to make bigger recipes, kind of like in computers, they supply you with code that you can use to make scroll bars and buttons and windows. You don't have to write those again every time you write a program. You just include them in your code and then you build on them. So you can do the same thing with Aquarium. And then you take your code that describes your experiments and you submit them across the abstraction barrier into the lab. And in the lab, there's equipment and instruments and a sample management system and technicians who read through your code and do exactly what it says. They've been trained to understand how to interpret this code, and they do your experiment for you. It's actually that one act of first specifying what you want to have happen and then having somebody else do it that helps solve this problem of reproducibility, if that makes any sense. So if the technicians are improvising, by the way, all of that is captured. There's sensors all over the lab. All of the samples are tracked. Everything that any instrument ever did is tracked, and other things are tracked as well, temperature and so on. And all of that information is sent back to you. And from your point of view, you wrote a program, you submitted it to a computer, and out came information on the other side the same way that you do with normal computers. And so you can use that abstraction barrier to be creative at a certain level and not have to worry about all of the details because they're going to be kept track of. And we tried this out on some engineers who didn't know anything about biology, but they knew how to program. We basically taught them how to program biology in 10 weeks. By the end of the 10 weeks, they were stitching together genes from little bits of DNA. They were turning They were making gene networks where they take genes and hook them up into networks that can do interesting programs. They were taking those gene networks and putting them into bacteria and testing the bacteria to see if they did what they did. They did in 10 weeks what used to take us months and months and months to work, to get to work. And it was really reproducible too. They all had to take their code and have other technicians run it as well. And for the most part, they were all able to get the other technicians to reproduce their results from the outset because they had coded in this language. So this aquarium idea, this idea of programming the lab, enables us to build new biotechnology, new living devices, by making things more reproducible. Maybe by doing this, we can make it so that it's 52 out of 53 results instead of 6 out of 53 results. And so by programming the lab, I think what we can do is make it so that we put that element of creativity back into programming for biology, that we can share each other's results, we can build on results that other labs produce, and that the entire field can move faster and more reliably towards a biotechnology that works for us. And ultimately, I think we can use those programs, those living systems that we build, to solve some of the really important problems facing us today.